taste and see that the Lord is good. I am Mother Mary Price and Father Amos Price. We will be doing the call to worship. On behalf of our pastor, Christopher A. Bourne, and Lady Heather Bourne, church family, special guests, visitors, and friends. Today is our United Ushers Ministry 79th anniversary celebration. Welcome and Hospitality 43rd celebration. Our scripture for today will be read by Father Amos Price.
Our scripture will come from Psalms 34, stanzas 1 through 3. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. This is the word of God.
Shall we pray? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. I come to you, dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, how we thank you for being our Heavenly Father. We thank you, Lord, for you let your guardian angels watch over us all night long while we slumbered and slept. Most of all, Lord, we thank you for your grace and we thank you for your mercy. Oh God, how we thank you for every blessing. Oh God, I ask you to bless every member of this parish in the name of Jesus. Lord, I ask you to bless our listening friends today. Bless those who wanted to be here, but they could not, Lord. Now, Lord, I ask you in the name of Jesus to hold us in the hollow of your hands and keep us in your care, Lord. Oh, God, without you, we are nothing. Oh, but with you, Lord, we can do all things through Christ who strengthened us. We thank you, Lord, for your many, many blessings. Oh, God, keep us in your care, Lord. And, oh, God, you said in your word, if we keep our minds stayed on thee, you'll keep us in perfect peace. Thank you, Lord, for keeping us in perfect peace, Lord. And, oh, God, I ask you to continue to hold us in the hollow of your hands. Keep us in your care, Lord. Oh, God, you're such a kind God. You're such a merciful God. You're such an understanding God. And oh God, we thank you for you love each and every one of us. And oh God, we ask you to continue to bless us throughout this service for today, Lord. I ask you to bless all of our associate ministers, Lord. I ask you to bless Pastor Christopher A. Bourne and keep him steadfast. Keep him unmovable. Always abounding, Lord, in the works of the Lord, and his labor will not be in vain. Lord, I ask you to bless Pastor Dillard and family. Thank you, Lord, for another year, and oh God, we thank you for another celebration. And oh God, we ask you to continue to bless us, keep us in your care. Teach us how to walk in your word, Lord, and teach us how to talk in your word. Oh God, order our steps in your word. Now let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, oh Lord, my strength, my redeemer. Amen, and thank God.
Good morning. Welcome to Second Baptist Church in Monrovia. My name is Del Kane. On behalf of Pastor Christopher Bourne, Lady Heather, and the entire church family, we welcome you. Today is a special day as we celebrate both the United Ushers and the Welcome and Hospitality Annual Day. Can you believe it? Just over a year ago, we celebrated this annual day in our church sanctuary. Though many things have changed over the past year, by the grace of God, we continue to serve a mighty, loving God. Again, welcome and enjoy the church service. Hallelujah belongs
to you. Good morning, church family and friends. I am Sheila McGinnis Woods, and I have the privilege of doing the offering appeal. Our scripture today will be coming from Malachi 3 and 10. Once again, Malachi 3 and 10. And it reads as follows. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven, and pour out for you such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. This is the word of God. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I come to you first of all to say thank you. Thank you for all that you do and who you are. Father God, you are a God that sits high and looks low, and know everything that we need before we even ask it. Father God, I ask right now that you would bless those who were able to give, and Father God, bless those that had a willing heart to give but could not. I ask that you would just touch them right now, Father God. I thank you and I praise you for being the great provider. In the name of Jesus, amen. There are three ways that you can give. The first is to mail your tithes and offering to P.O. Box 479, Monrovia, California, 91017. The second way is to download the Give Plus app. Search for Second Baptist Church of Monrovia. The third way is the website, svcmonrovia.org/give. Remember, tithes is a debt that we owe, and offering is a seed that we sow. Thank you so much, and have a blessed day.
Genocide to show just how much. celebrate the upcoming summer holidays with family and friends in a safe environment. SBC, in partnership with Set for Life and Kaiser, are scheduling people for the Pfizer vaccine at Cal Poly Pomona. Call the church at 626-358-2136 Tuesdays through Thursdays from 9 to 4 with your name, address, date of birth, email, phone number, mother's maiden name, and the day of week and time between 9 and 4 p.m. you prefer to get an appointment to have your COVID-19 vaccination.
Pastor Eric invites you to SWAT every third and fourth Saturday at 10 a.m. Meeting ID and passcode in the post.
God's Word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. So join us at 7 p.m. for Wednesday in the Word.
Save the date. Black Life Matters. Teen Summit on June 26, 2021. Must RSVP in order to attend at sbcteensummit@gmail.com. Hope to see you there.
Black Life Matters, 365 days a year. Every Thursday at 7 p.m., Dr. Harris and the Boosters explore with the teens what they can do to express themselves within their community. Join them.
Communion is every first Sunday. If you are on our mailing list, you will receive 2 months' worth of elements every other month. But you can still pick up your elements if you need to, on the last Saturday of each month from 12 to 2 p.m. See you on YouTube at 10:45.
TIP, Teens in Progress, is back, and we want every teen you have to experience the love of God. Teens learn and understand God's Word with their peers. Every Sunday at 9:45, see the posting for more details.
Baptist family and friends, Sister Leticia here, and on behalf of the United Women's Fellowship Youth, I would like to invite all of the ladies out on April the 10th at 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. to a Hearing and Sharing Day of Refreshing. You can register for this event by email, text, or phone call. The email address is formerlt@verizon.net, and the two numbers that you can text or call are 626-529-6466 and 626-253-1040. The registration will be first to sign basis, so please pick a time that will be suitable for you. Hey ladies, come on out. Be uplifted, edified, and refreshed. Please see the flyer for more details. God bless you, and I hope to see you on April the 10th.
And those are your announcements for this week.
Soldier, hold. precious and so divine. Lover of my soul, Jehovah, one and only God, I am Jesus Christ, the Holy Lamb. King of kings and Lord of lords, lover of my soul, Jehovah, one and only God, I am Jesus Christ, the Holy Lamb.
He's a wonder, he's a wonder,
he's a wonder,
he's a wonder
in my soul.
Church's Youth Usher Group, and we hope you enjoy today's service. If every usher was just like me, what would this usher board be? I am the answer.
Thank you, and I hope you enjoyed the service, and I hope you have another blessed week.
Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to the historic Second Baptist Church of Monrovia, right here in the Gem City of the Foothills. What a joy it is for us to come together to worship God's most holy and precious name. Listen, His name is high and it is lifted up. When we lift up the name that's above every name, demons tremble, souls are saved, lives are changed, bodies are healed. As a matter of fact, I just need you to help me call on His name one time. Can you just shout out the name? Jesus. Amen. After shouting out His name, I know you feel a lot better. Listen, today is a special day, as all of the Lord's days are. But today is the day that we get an opportunity to celebrate, to appreciate our ushers and our greeters. They are our hospitality ministry. I need you to help me just appreciate them right where you are. Will you just put your hands together and let's thank God for all of our ushers and all of our greeters and those that serve in our hospitality ministry. We're so thankful to God for them. Listen, even though we have not been able to meet over this year's time, we just believe that God is still encouraging them and preparing them, because when we are able to come back, they are going to be the ones that greet you with a smile. And listen, they're going to usher you from the outer courts into the most holy of holies, into the presence of God in the beautiful edifice right here at Second Baptist Church. I'm so thankful for the leadership team that serves faithfully amongst our ushers and greeters. I appreciate and love you with the love of God. I pray that God will continue to bless you and encourage you, even in the midst of this pandemic, when we can't gather, that you continue to do what you're doing, because you're positively impacting our church community. Thank you so very much. Today, I get an opportunity to introduce the speaker of the hour. He is a dear brother and friend. He is the proud pastor of the Friendship Church of Pasadena. God has blessed him down through the years. He's been serving that church faithfully for some 25 years. He's my big brother. He's known across the ecumenical lines as just a man of God, a man of faith, a man of friendship. He is the pastor, and his name is Pastor Lucius W. Smith. I want you to praise God for my brother as he comes to declare the word of God to you on today. I know that we're going to be blessed. Receive Pastor Lucius Smith of Friendship Baptist Church.
Well, good morning, Second Baptist Church family. God bless you. If you don't know me, I am Pastor Lucius Smith from the Friendship Pasadena Church family, and I am so pleased to have been invited to speak a word to you as a congregation, but even more specifically to your ushers, your greeters, your hospitality teams, and anybody that is in the service-oriented ministry. It is a great blessing. I want to thank Pastor Chris Bourne and everybody that had anything to do with even considering little old me to be able to stand before you in this forum and to bring a word that I pray will encourage you, I pray will glorify God, and I pray that it will just enable us all just to get a better understanding of what it is that God is calling for us to do and for us to be. I know that during the time of pandemic, this virtual way of worship and sharing God's word has become kind of the norm for just about a solid year now. But I know that Pastor Chris, I know that the ministerial staff and just the body of Christ at large is praying for the day when we will be able again to meet in our respective houses of worship, because there is nothing like worshiping the Lord together. I know that the Second Baptist family is being blessed because you have an incredible group of ministry staff. From your pastoral staff all the way down to the lay leadership, who is committed to bringing to you excellence, to bringing to you the word of God, and to try to create a sense of fellowship even in this this socially distant time. But I pray also that while we remain socially distant, that we are not spiritually distant, that in the Spirit of God, there is no distance, that we can literally be in the same place in the Spirit. We might be miles away from one another, but when we come into the presence of Almighty God, I know that God brings us together. And the Bible says, where two or three are gathered in my name, and I know that's very specific in regards to our personally gathering, but I believe that even in forms like this, that when we gather and get ourselves on one accord, when we gather around the Word of God, and when we depend completely on the Spirit of the living God, then I know that God has an incredible way of bringing us, amen, into His presence. And so therefore, when we're in His presence, we know that we are together and on one accord. So again, to everybody, specifically today, to the ushers, to the greeters, to the hospitality teams, I'm referring to you just like I would refer to the friendship family in the same way. You are the frontline workers. You are the essential workers that make it possible for us, specifically on Sunday mornings, to be able to worship freely, you know, to just come into God's presence and focus our attention on the Lord while the ushers are on their post and they're looking out for us, and while the greeters are outdoors, you know, welcoming people into the congregation, and the hospitality teams are making sure, again, that people are being blessed. You all make it possible, again, for us to enjoy God's presence in a way that if you were not there, if you were not committed to the ministries that you are doing, then I believe that we would all be missing out. So I want to extend to you my personal gratitude for your sacrifice. And I pray that this word today will be an encouragement to you. I'm still an invited guest, you know, and so I'm going to do all that I can to be mindful of your time, even though, you know, you're sitting at home, hopefully in a comfortable seat, and maybe you got your coffee or you've got a little breakfast, but, you know, still want to be mindful of your time. And so I'm just praying today, again, that God will be glorified, that you'll be encouraged, and that we will just be drawn closer together. So let's pray together even right now. Father God, in Jesus' name, how I bless you, Lord. I thank you that you are God all by yourself, and beside you there is no other. Thank you, Lord, that in these turbulent and tumultuous times that we can find our peace in you. You said, Lord, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and you will give us rest. So we rest in you, Father God. We rest in the fact that you watch over us. We rest in the fact, O Lord, that you continue to provide for us. We rest in the fact, Lord, that we know that you will bring this pandemic to an end according to your time. And I pray that we all will come out of it better, Lord. Some of us have had it very rough in this time. But your word told us, Lord, that you would never put more on us than we can bear. And so, Lord, we have borne up under this. We've made it this far by faith. And we know that however long we need to walk through this valley, that you will be with us. For you, O God, are with us in everything. You never leave us. You never forsake us. So be glorified, Lord, even in these next few moments, in Jesus' name, amen, amen, and praise the Lord. Again, blessings to the ushers, greeters, and the hospitality teams for everything that you've done. And what I'm about to say would make a little bit more sense if we were actually in a gathered congregation. But I believe also, you know, that just like pastors, we're always on. We may not be standing in front of people and preaching, but you know, there's that calling that's in us to always be basically doing what we're called to do 24/7. And I believe that can be a reality for ushers also, that while you may not be standing at the door of a church, there's a vigilance that's in you that wants to bring people into the presence of God and give them the best seat, so they can hear God's word and experience, you know, the Lord in the fullest. And greeters, you know, those who stand at the door with the smile on your face. You may not be, again, at your church doors, but I believe there's something in a greeter that is always reaching out, trying to, you know, draw people in to the Lord and make sure that they know that they matter. And folks that have the gift of hospitality. You're always looking for ways, you know, to make people feel comfortable. And we celebrate that. But if you were here today, if you were in this place today, I would invite you, and I don't know how awkward that it might be, but I would invite you to leave your post for just a few minutes, to kind of to stand down from that place of vigilance and go with me by the Spirit of God into the upper room that we find in St. John chapter 13. And that's going to be the focal point of what I believe is one of the most beautiful lessons that Jesus taught at the end of his ministry. And to frame all of this, I want to use as a title for a message, the sacrifice of service. That anybody who serves people, anybody who has taken it upon themselves to become a servant, really, you have to sacrifice certain things. You have to sacrifice some time. You have to sacrifice some emotions sometimes. You have to sacrifice, you know, getting compensated for it. Because when you're called to service, when service for the Lord is more of a calling than an obligation, then it's something that really won't let you not do it. And so servants of the Lord are always on their post. They're always being called upon. But today, just for a few moments, I want to invite you to go with me again into the upper room. It is at the end of Jesus' 3.5 year earthly ministry, the end of his 33-year life. And he's already done some incredible miracles. He's already taught, you know, thousands of people at a time on hillsides and by the lake and as he walked down the street. But now he's in a very intimate setting with his closest friends. He actually says in the upper room that I no longer call you servants, but I now call you friends, because servants don't know their master's business. So this is an intimate time. It is a beautiful, like a closing scene. And we know the terror and the horror that awaits him in the next few hours. But before he goes to the cross, he sits with his disciples and they are reclining. They've done this at least 2 times prior, because Jesus was with them for 3 years. But there's something unique about this one. And there's a lesson that I know Jesus is going to teach that I pray will be an encouragement to all of us in the service, kingdom service industry. So go with me, if you will, to St. John chapter 13. And if you have a Bible that has the little markers that tells you what you're about to read, what we're about to look at is the encounter where Jesus washes the disciples' feet. And I know that this has been preached, and I know that you know it's so simple, really, that you can kind of hear it once and, you know, kind of dismiss it from your mind. But I'm praying that God will show us greeters, ushers, hospitality ministry, and anybody that has a servant's heart, maybe something that you hadn't quite seen or presented in a way that you hadn't quite heard. So St. John chapter 13, verse 1. And today I want to read from the New King James Version. I usually use the NIV, but I'm praying that today that God will grant grace in the New King James. It says this: Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come and that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. This is going to be a love story. Jesus' entire life was a love story. What he's about to show them is a beautiful picture of what he really wants them to understand. Verse 2, and supper being ended, the devil having already put it in the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hand and that he had come from the Father and was going to God, rose from the supper and laid aside his garments, took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poured water in a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel which he had girded around him. Then he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, "Lord, are you washing my feet?" Jesus answered and said to him, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "If I do not wash you, you have no part with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "He who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not all of you." For he knew who would betray him. Therefore, he said, "You are not all clean." Lord kind of dropped something in my spirit as I was reading this again, something that in my, as Pastor Nick Sherman here at Friendship would say, in my sanctified imagination. When I read stories like this, I always try to put myself in the scene. I just don't want to read it and say, well, that happened way back then. As a disciple, as a child of God in the realm of the Spirit, I believe that God will allow us to superimpose our presence into the scene. So when Jesus is speaking to the early disciples, he's saying those exact same things to us. So I kind of, you know, not in the immediate circle, but I kind of put myself over in the corner. And I just kind of wonder what it must have been like, because, again, this was about the third time at least that they had a Passover meal with Jesus. And who knows what the conversation was the previous year. He may have dropped a few hints as to being the Lamb of God and what he was actually going to do. But now he is literally hours away from his crucifixion and his suffering. And so I just wonder what the disciples were thinking. They were, you know, they were just in the circle. And maybe they were talking about some of the miracles that Jesus had done. Like, you know, remember that time when we were out in the boat and, you know, it was going all crazy and we thought we were going to die. And then we saw Jesus walking on the water, man. That was crazy. And old Peter, you know, he jumps out of the boat and Peter starts walking. Man, that was really something to see Jesus walk on water. Yeah, but what about the time that he fed the 5,000? Man, all we had was 5 loaves, 2 fish, and we thought we were done. But Jesus, man, he multiplied it and fed 5,000 men plus women and children. And then we got 12 baskets full back. That was wild. Oh, bro. But what about that time that we saw that leper on the side of the road? Man, that was scary, because you know that if you touch a leper, you get it. But Jesus walked over to the dude and touched him and he got healed. That was wild. It reminds me of that time where the dead guy, Lazarus, was dead and Jesus called his name and he came back to life. And I see the conversation of maybe them reflecting on all of these incredible miracles. And then as the meal is ending, they see Jesus stand up. And I wonder if anybody in the crowd, because me back in the corner, I'm thinking to myself, well, what is he about to do now? And Jesus gets up and takes off his outer garment, takes off his robe. I believe it's the same robe that they said that the people would cast lots for. There was such a beautiful robe, and perhaps it was a symbol of his priestly nature, a symbol of his humility in the earth. And Jesus takes off that outer garment and then grabs a towel, wraps it around his waist. And again, I'm thinking, what is Jesus doing? I've seen him do some wild stuff, but what is he doing now? He wraps this towel around his waist, grabs a basin, fills it with water, gets down on his hands and knees, and begins to wash the disciples' feet. See, I'm blown away just by the fact that God in the flesh that this God-man, the one that it says that in him dwelt the fullness of the Godhead bodily, that the Word of God, who was with God, became flesh and dwelt among us and did all these incredible, powerful miracles. Now this God-man, this Son of God, this Jesus who came to save mankind from their sins has now taken off that outer garment, wrapped a towel around his waist, and is now going around a room of just average, ordinary, flawed, and finite human beings, and he is washing their feet. And I know that like all the other miracles that they were trying to wonder, what's he doing? And in that moment, Jesus, I believe, in this moment of incredible intimacy, this moment of incredible vulnerability, was showing them something as powerful as any other miracle that he had performed. A lesson that was so valuable that we and they may have missed it if he hadn't taken the time to explain it. So let's keep on reading. Drop down to verse 12. When he'd washed their feet, taken his garments and sat down, he said to them, "Do you know what I've done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say that well because that's who I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet." Sacrifice, service. "For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who sent him greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, you'll be blessed by them." Serving others, I believe, is the best way to demonstrate a Christ-like attitude. We live in a time where Christianity has been redefined as I see it, that as I peruse my Facebook page and as I look over social media and sometimes listen to the conversations, or should I say, I listen in on the conversations that folks are having. In my humble opinion, I believe that Christianity has been so redefined as to things that it really shouldn't be and things that it really isn't, that we need to get back to what I believe is one of the purest aspects of what it means to be Christ-like, to have a Christ-like nature. Jesus, the Son of God, born of a virgin, the whole sky was lit up with an angelic choir to remind the world, you know, that this is God's Son, and all of the incredible miracles that Jesus did his whole life, the walking on the water, the feeding of the 5,000, the raising of the dead, that one time that the guy came to church and his hand was withered, and Jesus just made his hand come. All of these amazing miracles. Now, at the end of his life, Jesus is teaching them, and I believe showing them, what it really means to have a Christ-like character, what being a servant is all about. That Jesus was not only the victorious king that would rule and reign over a kingdom forever and ever, but he was also the suffering servant. And our oft times in our Christian life, we love to talk about the victories. We love to talk about the overcoming nature of being a believer. But sometimes that suffering piece, sometimes that serving piece, sometimes that humbling ourselves so that God can be glorified, and we may have to endure some things for his glory. I believe that that's when we look just like Jesus, that when we serve other people, we look just like Jesus. So watch this: when you stand on your post, and you have your uniform on, and your heart is right before God, because again, it is a calling and not just something that you're doing. When you're in that position and you realize that you are literally ushering people into the presence of Almighty God, you look just like Jesus. Greet is when you stand at the door and you invite people in and you meet them with a smile, sometimes even when you don't feel like smiling. Sometimes even when you've gone through a hard day or a hard work, but now you have to step into that role that you were called to. All of a sudden now, suddenly those weights that kept you down all week, suddenly they're not quite as heavy because you're answering the call to bring people into the presence of Almighty God. hospitality people, not just, you know, I got to go and fix the coffee or I've got to do all this other kind of stuff, but I love making people feel warm and welcome. You look just like Jesus in those moments. So that leads me directly into my first point, is that when we have an attitude of service, that is the best way to honor God, because number one, here it is, that honoring God and serving God imitates our Savior. That's what Christianity is. That's what it means to be Christ-like, to be like Christ. Jesus himself said, I did not come to be served, but to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many. In this time where people, they want to see how much they can get from God. In this time where people just want to have an understanding of how much even I can do for God. Wouldn't it be better to have that servant attitude of, Lord, how can I serve you? What can I do in this world to make other people know how valuable they are, just like you made me know how valuable I am? That's why scripture says in the book of Philippians 2:5, it says, let this mind be in you. The NIV says, your attitude should be the same. That we should have a Christian and a godly attitude. And can I tell you, and I know none of y'all know anybody like this, but to meet a pastor, to meet a minister, to meet an usher, to meet a greeter, to meet somebody on the hospitality team that has a bad attitude, it kind of undoes the whole thing. And again, I know that ain't nobody like that at Second Baptist. And in case anybody from Frenchman is watching, ain't nobody here like that either. But in those odd times where you go in and maybe you run into that usher that just had a bad day and they want you to know it. When you have the heart of Christ, and I realize that I'm not here just because I want to be, but I'm here because God has called me to be here. Let this mind be in you. Your attitude should be the same like Jesus, who being in the very form of God, did not think it robbery to be equal with God. Watch this. But made himself of no reputation. Ooh, sometimes that's hard. Sometimes it's hard to leave your reputation at the door. Sometimes it's hard when folks don't really appreciate who you are. First of all, as a human being. Second of all, as a child of God. Third of all, in the position that you roll. The Bible says that Jesus was not after reputation. He was after service. Man, if the body of Christ at large could just grasp that. Thank God that God has placed you in the reputation that you have out in the world. Thank God that you're the CEO. Thank God that you're the president. Thank God that you're the chairperson. Thank God that you have the acclaim of the world. But the Bible says that the Son of God, God in the flesh, came into this earth, and he did not come basically to let folks know who he was and what he could do. The Bible says that Jesus made himself of no reputation. And the Bible says we're supposed to have that same mind. Thank God for every pastor. Thank God for every anointed ministry gift that God has placed in the church. But we should all have this mind in us. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, that even though Jesus in his very form was God, did not think robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking on the form of a bond servant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself. Don't forget, he's washing feet. That might be one of the most humbling things to ever do, is to get down on your hands and knees and wash somebody's feet. Now, washing feet does not automatically or it's not limited to the physical act of washing feet. But it is the attitude of being so very humble that if I have to put my position off, if I have to sacrifice my reputation in the community, my reputation in the church, my reputation that I've worked my whole life to build up, that when I come before the Lord, God, listen, God doesn't call me pastor. I don't know if you knew that or not. When I come into God's presence, God doesn't call me Pastor Smith, because my title in his presence doesn't matter. He blessed me with it. He's anointed me to walk in it too. But when I serve other people, it sounds good to be called Pastor Smith. But sometimes you can get that title and you can start wearing it. You refuse to take off your outer garment. I'm getting all messed up in my sermon because I had a very structured sermon for the Second Baptist Church family. I wanted to show y'all that I could stay on track, and I wanted to show y'all that I could follow directions. But watch this. Jesus took off his outer garment. In other words, in that moment, he took off his title. In that moment, he was not King of Kings. He actually was, but to them, he was a servant. Because what did he say? He said that a master doesn't do this kind of thing. Because masters and servants, they have rules and roles that they have to occupy. You see, watch this. Sometimes I think people reach for a title before they reach for a towel. Just let that echo in your spirit. We want to be the chairperson. We want to be the head of this. We want to be the lead that. We want to be senior pastor. We want to be bishop. We want to be apostle. And nothing is wrong with those titles. But when it comes to service, I got to do what God has called me to do, because Jesus showed me how. In order for me to really demonstrate my love for him, I need to imitate my Savior by getting down on my hands and knees, by taking off my title, taking off my position, and grabbing a towel. Jesus took off his outer garment, wrapped himself in a towel, and got down on his hands and knees. He humbled himself. And the Bible tells us, humble yourself under the hand of Almighty God, and what will he do? He'll lift you up. Because the other part of that verse that I wasn't even going to quote, he took upon himself the form of a and became obedient, even obedient unto death on a cross. Therefore, because of that, God gave him a name that is above every name. And he highly exalted him and gave him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. I believe that when we serve God, God will give us a name that no one else knows. He'll give us a name. He'll give us a title greater than any other title that you can earn in the earth realm. Because you are imitating your Savior. Our mind is now just like Jesus. I know who I am. And I hope that you respect your pastors, because they're worthy of respect. I hope that you respect your elders. I hope that you respect the men and women that stand at the door as a calling on their life to usher you into God's presence. That when they tell you, hold on, just hold on. That when they tell you, we can't let you in, be with that. Because they're serving the Lord, and they're serving you. Let's imitate God through our service, because I believe that really is what Jesus is saying. Like everything else that Jesus did, Jesus basically was saying, watch this. Watch what I'm about to do. Not walking on water today. Not raising the dead today. Not healing the blind. Not cleansing the lepers. Not feeding the multitude. Not even teaching powerful, insightful messages like the Sermon on the Mount. But today, let me show you what my love for you really looks like. Took off his garment, wrapped himself in a towel, and began to wash their feet. When you serve the Lord, number one, we imitate our Savior. Point two, just like I said earlier, that service for the Lord is really an act of love. Because what was Jesus doing? Verse 1 says that Jesus, knowing that his earthly ministry was complete, he now showed them what his love really looked like. He loved them to the end. And in that act of love, he took off the outer garment and began to wash their feet. So not only does our service imitate our Savior, but it also demonstrates our love. Service, I believe, is one of the greatest acts of God's love. Let me just inject this. God does not call us only to love those who love us. Because there's somebody in this room. There's somebody in this intimate setting. There's somebody who's witnessing, like he had witnessed all the other miracles, but now he's witnessing this beautiful, tender act of love. And still, he would betray him. Judas is in the room. See, we focus on Peter because Peter said, no, Lord. You cannot wash my feet, because Peter did not feel worthy. But when it came to Judas, we hear of no objection. Judas was like, yeah, me too. Because the Bible says that Satan had already prompted Judas to betray Jesus. And sometimes people that have done you wrong. See, this is what I mean by it demonstrates our love. God calls us to love those who don't love us, to pray for those who have done you wrong. Come on, ushers. I know sometimes you open the door for that person that told that lie on you. You usher them down the aisle to perhaps the best seat. And I pray that your heart is right, that you're not putting them under the air conditioning vent so they can freeze during the service. I know that y'all would not do that. But I pray that just like Jesus bent down at the feet of the one who would betray him. And I don't believe that Jesus took any less time on the feet of Judas, that he washed the feet of Judas as thoroughly and as lovingly and as tenderly as he washed even John, the one who said the disciple whom Jesus loved. And again, I'm just a fly on the wall. I'm just watching all of this. Judas, you low down, dirty snake, how can you come into the presence of these incredible people, witness this incredible act of love, and still leave and go and betray your master? Come on, I just need to say this as a pastor. When someone can come into the presence of an incredible service where the love of God is overflowing and they go outside and get on the phone and say, brother, did you see what he was wearing? Did you hear what he said? That's a Judas spirit. And Jesus loved Judas too. He knew what he was going to do. But there he is, Judas in the crowd, demonstrating his love. The Bible says this in 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. Beloved, let us love one another. Why? Why? Why do I have to love people? Because love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love, not an emotion, that's a response to other people that love me. Because the Bible says Jesus loved the whole world. Even though the world was going to reject him, he loved us anyway. Behold what manner of love the Father has for us. And while you and I, while we were still in our sins, God sent his son to die for us. That's love. And Jesus washing their feet, even the one that betrayed him, is an act of love. So ushers, greeters, hospitality team, members of a congregation with a servant's heart. God calls us to serve in spite of the fact that you may never be appreciated. In spite of the fact that you serve others, they may still not give you the accolades and the acclaim that you deserve. Because watch this. Jesus also said, do you want to know? Jesus didn't put it like this, but do you want to know how the world is supposed to know that we really are his disciples, not just followers? There's a difference in followers and disciples. Followers are there for the fish and the bread. Followers are there for the miracles. Followers are there for what Jesus can do for you. But when he no longer does things the way you want him to, then we stop following. But disciples are there because he's called us out of darkness into the marvelous light. And I can't help but answer this calling. And so I'm calling. Jesus said, if you want to know how the world is supposed to know how you're my disciples, this is how: by the love you have for one another. And I believe that the greatest act of demonstrated love is Jesus on his knees, towel around his waist, title hung up in the corner, washing the feet of people who really didn't understand, people who had yet to really appreciate, and one guy that was determined to do him wrong. Jesus loved the unlovable. So when you serve, not only do you imitate your Savior, not only do you demonstrate your love, here's the third point, is we anticipate his praise. Notice what Jesus says in verse 17. He says, if you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. It amazes me, really, how oftentimes people want God to bless what they do, but don't do what God says he will bless. Lord, I'm about to do this thing, you know, because I've wanted to do it my whole life. And, you know, I think you're in it. I hope you're in it. So I'm going to go out here and do my thing. And, Lord, I hope that you bless it. And the Lord might very well bless you. But God says, if you do this, you'll be blessed. If we have an attitude of service, like Jesus washing the disciples' feet. He said, if you remember and you do these things, if you have an attitude of service, if you're willing to have a sacrifice of service, then I believe that you will know that you are blessed. Because Jesus tells a parable. Actually, it's a little story. And I don't know when was the last time I actually heard this preached. Luke chapter 12, and I'm rushing to a close. In Luke 12, verses 35 through 38. It's actually part of a story, a parable that Jesus is telling about the faithful servants, but also the unfaithful, because there are two different kinds of servants. There are those that you can depend on, and there's those that you got to chase down. Come on, somebody. You know it was your time to be on the door this Sunday, but you didn't call in and check. Or check in. I don't want to go down that path because I don't want y'all to get mad at me. I'm invited. Amen. But Jesus tells this story in Luke 12, and listen to it carefully. He's talking about faithful service. Just going to talk about the faithful one. He said, let your waist be girded and your lamps burning. In other words, he's telling these servants to be ready. Don't forget, scripture said Jesus girded. That's an old King James word. He wrapped this towel around it. It's a towel of service. And so he says, let your waist be girded and your lamps burning. Watch this. And you yourselves like people who wait for their master. That's what a servant does. A servant waits on and waits for their master. When he will return from the wedding, that when he comes and knocks, then you may open to him immediately. Blessed. Here's another one. Blessed are those servants whom the master, when he comes, will find watching. I couldn't help but remember that I was told by our usher ministry that when we're up here praying, when we bow our heads in prayer, I'm told that if not all the ushers, that at least one of them, they don't close their eyes. They're praying in the spirit, but they're watching. They're looking around. They're making sure that while we got our eyes closed, there ain't nobody sneaking up on you. That ain't nothing jumping off in the background. There's much a part of the service, but they are watching. So again, ushers, greeters, hospitality ministry, and anybody in the service-oriented ministry calling, I'm praying that you will hear this word. It says, blessed, that when the master comes, he will find you watching. Listen, assuredly, most assuredly, Jesus might say, verily, verily, I say to you, listen, that he, the master, will gird himself and have you sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. I don't know if you understand what you just heard and what I just read. Jesus said that when we are faithful servants, that we live our lives with a servant's attitude, that if we do what God calls us to do, that when he comes back, there will come a time that just like Jesus made these brothers to sit down and he washed their feet, that the master, the Lord himself, will come and cause us to sit down, and he will come and serve us. That is mind-blowing for me, because I know how many times I have disqualified myself from the grace of God. I know how many times I've doubted God. I know how many times the weakness of my flesh has risen up and fought against the very calling of God in my life. But the Bible tells me and says the same thing to you, that if you remain faithful in your service as an usher, in your service as a greeter, in your service in the hospitality ministry, in your service in whatever calling it might be, that there's going to come a time where we hear the most amazing words that any believer in time immemorial has ever desired to hear. We want to hear God say, well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in the little things. You were faithful when nobody was watching. You were faithful when nobody gave you your accolades. You were faithful when even the people that you sought to serve turned on you like Judas turned on Jesus. And yet you remain true. And you're going to hear those words, well done. And if I read correctly, the Bible says that the master will cause you to sit down. See, while we're seated and y'all are standing, there's going to come a time where the Lord himself is going to flip the script. He's going to say, I saw you on your post. I was watching that even when you, when that tear ran down your eye because you didn't feel as though you're being appreciated, I appreciate you. And Jesus said that you will be blessed if you will just continue to walk in that, and you will hear those words. You may never get a plaque. You may never get the red sash or whatever it might be. You may never have the audience stand and applaud your service on a Sunday morning. And I would encourage Pastor Chris, and I would encourage everybody that on one of these Sundays, especially when we get back, that we celebrate those servants, those essential workers, our ushers, our greeters, our hospitality ministry, and everybody that caused this thing to go on in the midst of the pandemic. Our media teams, our camera crew, everybody that y'all don't even know that have made things like this possible, that we will celebrate you. And so I celebrate you because your sacrifice of service has not gone unnoticed. When you serve the Lord, number one, you imitate your Savior because Jesus did not come to be served, but to serve. You also demonstrate your love because greater love has no one than this, that a man would lay down his life for his friends. And Jesus, again, is just hours away from paying the ultimate price. And one of the most purest, beautiful lessons he ever taught was not raising of the dead this time, not feeding the thousands this time, was a simple act of service that he told them that if you do this, you'll be blessed. And when I do that, I can anticipate his praise, that I will hear those words, well done, my good and faithful servant. And like Paul said, he said, I fought a good fight. This is not a eulogy, so don't turn me off. But Paul was able to say before he left, I fought a good fight. I finished my course. I kept the faith. And he said, now there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. But not only to me, but to all of those who stood their post. To all of those who went out of their way to make people feel welcome. To all of those who imitated their Savior, demonstrated their love, but also anticipated his praise. I pray that you will be encouraged, that anyone listening today, but specifically the ushers, greeters, the hospitality teams of Second Baptist Church in Monrovia, under the leadership of the glorious pastor, Christopher A. Boyd, my friend and little brother. Slightly younger, a little less attractive, but I love him like family. I pray that you all will be blessed and encouraged. But let me say this also. Jesus was the greatest servant, and he served us by giving his life, paying a price that we could never afford to bring us into a presence that we couldn't ever earn. And the Bible says that if you will simply today, if you will confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, that means that you abdicate control of your life and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you can be saved. I know that the ministry staff of Second Baptist is eagerly waiting to hear from you that you want to know more about this Jesus. So I just pray that you just put it in your comment section, if there's a comment section in this forum, or that you will contact the Second Baptist Church family and tell them, I want to know more. I want to know more about what it means to be a servant of this incredible God. So from the Friendship Pasadena Church family to the Second Baptist Church family, we send our love, we send our blessings, we send everything that we have, and we pray for the time where we can all meet in the same place. Man, you talking about a worship experience. When we get back together, Pastor Chris going to preach, and we're going to be there all day. My God, it's going to be glorious. I just want to be a fly on the wall, just like I was in the upper room. So be blessed. Be encouraged. May God keep you in his care. And don't forget, the sacrifice of service carries amazing reward. Take care. Be blessed. Love y'all. See you soon.
I pray that you were blessed by that word on today. Thank you so very much for sharing the word of God with us. Now listen, after hearing the word, there should be a response to the word. If you want to respond to the word of God, if you hear God calling you for salvation and drawing you, there's going to be a number that says prayer. I want you to text that number. Maybe you say, Pastor, I'm already saved, but I just need prayer. Text that number. There are going to be some men and women of God available to pray with you and to lead you and to share the word of God with you to help you as you navigate through your life's journey. Before we leave, I want to bow and pray with you, but I want you to text that number. Just text that number. Let's pray. Our God and our Father, how we thank you and praise you for this time. We thank you for this word. Father, we know that your word will not return unto you void, but it's going to accomplish everything that you set forth for your word to accomplish in our lives. I thank you for these, your sons and daughters that have heard the word. And I thank you that we are not hearers only, but we are doers of the word of God. Now, I pray your blessings over them. I pray, God, that you will heal and that you will save and that you will strengthen and that you will deliver. Now, be with them, God. You know their most urgent prayer request. I pray that you will meet them at their point of need. Now, Father, we just give you all the thanks and praise for what is to come. We know that our lives are in your hands, so we trust you and we love you today. Now, Lord, there's so much more that we can pray. We pray for our nation and our world, our land. We pray for our communities, our church, our family. God, be with us. Strengthen us. Bless our ministries individual, God. And we just give you the thanks and praise for it now. Now, Lord, the things that we have failed to ask, I pray that you grant, because you know what we have need of. And we give you thanks and praise now in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Praise God. Listen, we pray that you were blessed today, and we want you to have a great week in God. Listen, remember this. I love you with the love of the Lord, and there ain't one thing you could do about it. And if the Lord should tarry his coming and the creek don't rise, we look forward to seeing you again real soon. In the meantime, stay safe, stay well, stay home, and be encouraged. God bless you. Have a good evening. Bye-bye.
Help me praise the Lord and say, may the Lord.